I'm 30 years old and today I understood how throwing works. Okay, honestly, it was some time ago when I decided to make this video, and it all started when I set up a simple system to test my simulation code. Just a few marbles connected to each other and one of them constrained to stay at a fixed location. And when the code finally worked, it surprised me with this beautiful whipping motion that I didn't really expect. I didn't really expect anything. Like I said, it was just supposed to be a very simple test system. But this whipping motion made me curious. Why exactly is this happening? The marbles are all the same. They all have the same mass. Why do we get this particular motion and not some more uniform swinging motion? To figure this out, I made a graph of the speeds of all marbles over time. And as you can see, initially all of them accelerate equally because they're all pulled down by gravity in the same way. But then, starting with the inner marbles, one after another is slowed down. That's because for all marbles to move in sync, the outer marbles need to travel much further compared to the inner marbles. The inner marbles have to slow down, essentially to wait for the outer marbles to catch up. The important bit is that in doing so, their kinetic energy is reduced and transferred to the outer marbles. The dashed line shows the speed that a freely falling object would have at this point, and we can see that some outer marbles are already faster than that. And as this process of inner marbles slowing down progresses outwards, more and more kinetic energy is accumulated in fewer and fewer beats, which finally leads to a spike in the speed of the outermost marble. This way, the tip can move incredibly fast, and in real-world whips, it can even break the sound barrier. The cracking sound of a whip is actually a sonic boom caused by the tip moving faster than the speed of sound. A common trick to enhance this effect is to use a tapered shape like this. And we can see that the tip moves way faster than before. This works because now a comparable amount of energy from the inner marbles is concentrated on an even smaller mass in the tip. I thought this was kind of nice, beautifully shows how whips work, but I didn't really understand the full implication of this simulation. I mean, who cares about whips? But anyway, I put it up on Reddit to share it with some other nerds who might still like this kind of analysis. And then, interestingly, people made comments like, "Oh, gotta show this to my volleyball friends," or "This explains what an ideal golf swing looks like." And apparently, the Reddit community didn't really appreciate these comments, but I thought they were amazing because that was when I realized that everyone cares or everyone should care about whips. Let's simply take throwing a ball as an example. I could throw like this, but that's not how I do it. I never consciously understood what I was doing, but through thousands of trial and error attempts in my youth, I arrived at this form. I have no idea if I have a particularly good throwing technique or anything, but anyway, my arm whips. If we look at the speed of my elbow and the ball over time, we can see that the inner part of my arm, my elbow, is accelerated initially, but then slows down, just like the inner marbles in the simulation. And the moment the ball leaves my hand and has reached its maximum velocity is the same moment when my elbow has almost completely come to rest. In this way, no kinetic energy is wasted on my elbow and is instead transferred to the outer parts of my arm and the ball. Essentially, whenever you want to accelerate something as much as possible, you need to whip. No matter if you're throwing a frisbee, slamming a volleyball across the net, or hitting a golf ball.
I have no idea how golf works.
I really like how my stupid little test simulation might actually help someone to improve their sports technique. But to me, what I find even more interesting is the story how this video evolved, because it reminded me of a valuable lesson that every young researcher has to learn, but one that is, I think, also relevant in many other areas. In research, there's really always two challenges. There's the challenge to create something good, experimental setup, a proper measurement, a simulation model, or whatever. And then there's the challenge, which is often overlooked, the challenge to understand the true value of what you have created. In so many cases, we set out to answer one specific question, we design an experiment, and then usually our experiment doesn't answer our original question. But that does not mean that our result is not valuable. In so many cases, there's something else that we can learn from our result. And if we're not open to see that, we miss most of the exciting research. Anyway, I'm Tobias and you're watching Marble Science. I make all kinds of simulation models to explore how stuff works. Thanks a lot to my supporters on Patreon. You're amazing. And see you next time. Bye.